Good evening, everybody. So welcome you all for this today evening's faculty talk. Dr. Namita is junior consultant at Aster CMI Hospital. So she will be delivering a talk on suture materials. So suture techniques, she will do on some other day. Topic is too vast, she thought. So over to Namita.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Dr. Namita. Today's topic for discussion will be suture materials. The term suture is derived from the Latin word sutura, which means a soon seam. A suture is a medical device used to hold the body tissues together after an injury or a surgery. A brief note on the history of sutures and suturing. It was mentioned in the Egyptian literature as early as the 16th century BC, which said, if thou examine a man having a wound on top of his eyebrow, draw together for him the gash with stitching. The first detailed description, however, on suturing and materials was given by Sushruta in 500 BC. The oldest suturing was done by an embalmer on mummies in about 1100 BC. In South America, large black ants were used to bite the wound together. Their jaws were used as a staple device. So what they used to do is the ant used to bite it with the jaw, and the body would be twisted, leaving behind the head to keep the wound apposed. The East African tribes used vegetable thorns with strips of vegetable matter to keep with a suture of figure of eight technique. They also used the tendon strips to ligate blood vessels. The Indian surgeons in 1000 BC used horsehair, cotton, and leather sutures. In Roman times, linen and silk, metal clips called the fibulae were used to keep opposed the gladiator wounds. With the development of textile industries in the 19th century, silk and catgut got popular. Lister used catgut and soaked them in chromic so that it prevented early dissolution in body fluids and tissues. Moynihan thought that chromic catgut was an ideal suture to be used, as it could be sterilized, it's a non-irritant to tissues, and kept its strength till the work was done and then disappeared. Galen, a Roman physician in the second century, used silk for hemostasis. Andreas Vesalius first advocated the suturing of fresh wounds, injured tendons, and nerves. Joseph Lister discovered that bacteria in the suture strands causes wound infection, and he disinfected the sutures with carbolic acid. So coming to suture, it can be divided into suture material and needles, under which headings we're gonna study the sutures today. So what all do we find on the packaging of a suture material? The right-hand corner is a product code. Vicryl Plus, which is the suture material, the material used to make the suture, which is polyglactin. Sometimes they give that whether it's a braided suture or a monofilament. 30 denotes the size of the suture. 45 centimeters is the length of the suture. Coming to the needles, you get to know whether it's a cutting, reverse cutting, a taper cut, the size of the needle, and the circle of the needle. You also know how it's sterilized. You have the expiry date and the batch number. So we're gonna study sutures in under two headings, the suture materials per se and the needle. So an ideal suture material have the following desired characters. It has to be easy to handle. Its behavior in tissue should be predictable. Its tensile strength should be predictable. It should be sterile. It should glide through the tissues easily without cutting through. It should secure the knotting ability. It should be inexpensive, have a minimal tissue reaction. It should be non-capillary, non-allergenic, non-carcinogenic, non-electrolytic, and non-shrinkage. The capillary action of a suture material is the ability of a suture to absorb the body fluids, which leads to bacterial growth and eventually infection. So coming to a few characteristics, when we talk about a physical structure in a suture, it can be divided into monofilament, multifilament, or something called the pseudomonofilament. A monofilament suture is smooth. It's made up of a single strand of a material. It has a decreased knot security due to high memory of the suture. It resists harboring of organisms and can be easily damaged by gripping it or holding it with the needle holder or forceps, which is called the fracture or a suture breakage. A multifilament or braided suture are several filaments or strands of suture, strands of a material twisted or braided together. They have greater tensile strength, they're pliable, and they're flexible. The surface area is increased. They have a greater surface area, which causes, due to the capillary action, interstices of, it may lead for the bacteria to lodge in them and cause infection and persistent infection and sinus formation. These materials can be coated to help them pass smoothly through the tissue and enhance the handling characteristics. So it's monofilament, multifilament, pseudo-multifilament. Pseudo-multifilament is when there are filaments of structures which make up the core and makes it a multifilament, but it's covered with a sheet which gives the appearance of a monofilament. These have less knot security. It slides through easily through tissues and are fairly flexible. Coming to the strength of a suture material, it depends on the constituent material, the thickness, and how it is handled in the tissue. What's a tensile strength? It's the force required to break it when we pull apart a suture. The accepted rule in this is the tensile strength of a suture never exceeds the tensile strength of the tissue in which the suturing is done. The size of the suture denotes the diameter of the suture material. Use of a smallest diameter suture is better as it minimizes the tissue trauma and minimizes mass of foreign material that is left behind in the tissue. The size is stated numerically, which is denoted using the United States Pharmacopoeia system. And as the number of zeros increases, the diameter of the strand decreases. The smaller the size, the lesser the tensile strength. So just to give an idea, zero or one zero suture, as we say, keeping that as a reference, when we go up, that's 1, 2, 3, the diameter of the suture material increases. And as we come down and the zeros increases, that's 20, 30, and 40, as we said, the diameter of the suture material decreases. Tensile behavior, every suture behaves differently depending on its deformability or flexibility. Deformability is when the cut surface of the suture changes. That's from a circular to a oval, or it becomes rigid. And there's something called the elasticity of a suture. When that's the suture returns back its length once the tension is removed from it. The flexibility of suture is an important characteristic. Memory is the inherent capability of a suture to return or to maintain its original gross shape. That is, it comes back to its packaging shape. So how do we get rid of the memory? A sharp but gentle pull diminishes it. Most of the times, a scrub nurse puts an artery forceps or a mosquito to the end of the suture material so that it doesn't curl up. So more the memory, lesser is the knot security. Coming to the absorbability of a suture, it can either be absorbable or non-absorbable suture, whose property must be taken into consideration while choosing a suture material. So for example, an absorbable suture should be used when we're doing a biliary or a urinary tract surgery, as it reduces the stone formation or tissue reaction. Whereas a non-observable suture is commonly used for vascular anastomosis, as it's greater predictable and it stays for a longer duration of time to hold the graft or prosthesis in place. The biological behavior of a suture. It depends on the constituent raw material that we use. So biological suture or natural sutures are proteolized. They're less predictable in tissues and causes local irritation of tissues. Synthetic polymers are hydrolyzed and are better predictable and are non-carcinogenic normally and are great and are better predictable in tissues. So coming to the classification of a suture material, they broadly classified as monofilament, multifilament, and pseudomonofilament, each of which can further be divided into absorbable or non-absorbable sutures. And that further can either be a natural suture or a synthetic suture. So absorbable synthetic sutures that we commonly use are Vicryl, Monocryl, and PDS. Absorbable natural sutures are collagen or plain surgical gut. Non-absorbable sutures can be synthetic. The commonly used one are ethylene or nylon, proline or polyester fibers. The natural is surgical silk or surgical steel. Coming to the classification of absorbable and non-absorbable sutures. Absorbable sutures, they are sutures which undergo rapid degradation in tissues, which loses almost up to 50% of their tensile strength within 60 days. It's used to hold wound edges in approximation temporarily. They're made up either of collagen of healthy mammals or synthetic polymer. They're either natural or synthetic, natural being digested by body enzymes which attack and break down the suture strands. Synthetics are hydrolyzed and results in lesser degree of tissue reactions. So what's the stages of absorption of a suture material in the body? There are two stages. The first stage, in which the tensile strength diminishes in a gradual, almost linear fashion. It takes up to several weeks. The second stage is considerably overlaps with the first stage and characterized by loss of suture mass. Both the stages exhibit leukocytic cellular responses, which serve to remove cellular debris and suture material from the line of tissue approximation. Either of the stages, that either the first stage or the second stage, can be affected by infection or protein deficiencies. The tensile strength is lost too quickly, and wound dehiscence can be manifested clinically. Coming to individual sutures, absorbable sutures.
Amita, can we wait here and take some questions? So there are a lot of comments and questions. All sutures have expiry date?
Yes, sir.
Yes? After expiry date, they should not be used?
Not be used.
Not be used?
Yes. Preferably not be used.
Anybody has any comments on that or can be used? Dr. Lakshman?
Well, strictly it should not be used.
Right.
Because there is a natural degeneration of the material itself that's concerned. And even a bigger concern is the sterility. So definitely all these things which are sterilized have a limited period. And even if it's packaged, you know, there will be minor microscopic damage to the package and sterility can be compromised. And there is a degeneration of the material also. So it should not be used after the expiry date.
Sterility and strength of the suture.
Strength of the suture.
Both will be compromised. Okay. Memory of the suture line is, I think she has covered.
Yeah, she's covered that.
Then can you give some example for this pseudo multifilament?
There's something called the Resorba or a Resolon. Resolon is made up of nylon and it's covered with nylon sheet. The Resorba is made up of PD polyglycinate.
What you are telling is there is one outer sheath and there are inside there are multi filament. No, I think we are not using any
It was a new thing I also learned.
No, we have a coated vicryl. We have a vicryl is normally it's a braided suture, but there is a coated vicryl that can be used.
Okay.
Because, particularly people who are concerned about doing extracorporeal knots in laparoscopic surgery, because it doesn't slide down as well as one would want it to. So coated vicryl is available.
So that is what you're talking about, the antibacterial niclosan coating.
It could be that also. There could be a non-antibacterial and an antibacterial. Both are available.
Okay.
Coated vicryl is available. I'm aware of that. Yeah.
Right.
But my interest, Namita, how do you know how the tensile strength is actually measured?
No, it's a force measured in pounds.
Well, it's kgs per square meter or whatever. The things are different, but do you know how it is actually measured? It's very interesting. I always felt that we should send our residents to a suture manufacturing unit. I have been to two such units, and it's always very, very educative to do that. There is a contraption where they have a single thread suspended in that machine, and they keep on increasing the weights little by little until the thread snaps. So one end is fixed, there's a gravity with a weight suspended, and they keep on adding. And there are standards for different kinds of sutures. So that's how they measure. And from every batch, they do this test to make sure that it has the recommended tensile strength. Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
So Madan is asking, is the length of suture is same for every material?
No, sir.
Obviously, no. Then Pawan, he has answered. What is breaking strength of a suture material? I think same as tensile strength. Anything
yes.
else you have in mind, Mahesh?
Hello.
Anything else you have in mind? Breaking.
Actually, the definition is limit of the tensile strength at which the suture failure occurs.
Okay. Okay, Namita. So, how do you select whether you want to use monofilament or multifilament?
So, depending on the site of the surgical site or the tissues that we have to operate on, the sutures will be selected.
Which one you prefer?
So GI, we prefer PDS, so vicryl.
So advantages of monofilament is over the multifilament and vice versa?
Yes. So it's easier to pass through a tissue. It doesn't cut through the tissue.
Cut.
And not...
See, knotting capacity is better with the multifilament sutures. Okay. Tissue reaction around the suture is more with multifilament. Bacterial colonization is more with multifilament. These are the three things I can think of. That's why wherever possible, monofilament is preferred. Wherever knotting is more important, multifilament is preferred.
Thanks.
Any comments on that? Okay, shall we move on?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Coming to the individual sutures, absorbable sutures, first we have the catgut. It's a purified collagen fiber from the intestines of healthy cows or sheep, more specific, the submucosa of the cattle, sheep. There are two types, plain and chromic. They rapidly absorb sutures. Plain sutures, absorption is by phagocytosis or enzymatic degradation. Absorption time is about 7 to 10 days. Chromic, when the catgut is treated with chromium salts to prevent faster dissolution, it raises the body's enzymatic digestion. Tensile strength is for about 10 to 14 days, and complete absorption takes place in about 90 days. It's used for closure of tissues that heal rapidly, like oral mucosa and ligating of superficial vessels. However, it is not used, no longer used because of the inflammatory cellular reaction with release of proteases and risk of transmission if of bovine origin. Coming to the next material, the polyglactin or the Vicryl. It's an absorbable braided multifilamentous suture, which is a copolymer of lactide and glycolide in the ratio 10:90. It has a retaining capacity of 60% at 2 weeks and 30% at 3 weeks. It's absorbed by hydrolysis and is completely absorbed by about 60 to 90 days. It's a workhorse suture in most general practice surgical practices, used in gut anastomosis, vascular ligatures, and ophthalmic surgeries. Vicryl Rapid is a braided synthetic absorbable suture treated with gamma rays to have a low molecular weight. Causes faster absorption with minimal tissue reaction. Shows about 50% original tensile strength at 5 days, and complete absorption takes place about 6 weeks. It's used for short-term wound support of superficial soft tissue mucosa and skin. Coming to the PDS or polydioxynone, it's an absorbable monofilament polyester polymer causing minimal tissue reaction. Its tensile strength is about 70% at 2 weeks, 50% at 4 weeks, and 14% at 8 weeks. Complete absorption takes place in about 180 days. It's used in particular where slightly longer wound support is required, favored in plastic, pediatric, cardiovascular, and ophthalmic surgeries, and commonly used for mass closure of abdomen. Polyglycapron 25, or Monocryl as commonly known, it's an absorbable monofilament, which is a copolymer of glycolide and epsilon caprolactone. Its tensile strength is about 21 days with absorption taking place by hydrolysis in 90 to 120 days. Causes minimal tissue reaction, used for subcuticular skin closures and ligation of superficial vessels. The other absorbable sutures, polytrimethylene carbonate or Maxon, which was commonly used, which is used for abdominal closure, but because it's expensive, we don't use it commonly. Polycaprolate, Polysorb, or polyglytone. So coated Vicryl or Vicryl Rapid dissolves for around 42 days. Monocryl by 90 to 120 days, coated Vicryl 56 to 70 or up to 90 days, PDS 180 to 210 days. Coming to the non-absorbable sutures, it maintains its tensile strength for longer than 60 days, not digested by body enzymes or hydrolyzed in body tissue. However, it's encapsulated or walled off by the fibroblasts. It's preferred where the persistent strength is required for a longer duration. Individual sutures, silk, it's a natural braided or twisted multifilament. The raw silk is obtained from silkworms. It can be coated, which causes to reduce the capillary action of the suture. The tensile strength, it loses 20% when wet and 80 to 100% by 6 months. Mediated by foreign body tissue response, it degrades slowly but progressively by enzymatic degradation of the fibers. It's used in ligation and suturing where long-term tissue support is necessary, and we use it commonly in securing drains. Proline, non-absorbable monofilament suture, polymer of propylene. It has a high memory, so it tends to coil more commonly. The handling characteristic is not very good for proline because of its memory. Tensile strength is more than 1 year, remains encapsulated in body tissues. It's used in cardiovascular surgeries commonly, hernia repair, plastic surgeries, ophthalmic and abdominal wall closure. Nylon or ethylene is a non-absorbable monofilament or multifilament suture, polyamide polymer, degrades at approximately 15 to 20% per year by hydrolysis and are eventually encapsulated if left in place. It's used in skin closure, soft tissue approximation, plastic, neuro, micro, or ophthalmic surgeries. Other suture materials are linen, surgical steel, which can either be monofilament or multifilament, indefinite tensile strength, and it has indefinite tensile strength and flexibility. However, it's difficult to handle, and there's risk of tearing tissues and puncturing the skin. Polyester or Ethibond is used commonly in orthopedics surgeries, and polybutester. A small note on barbed sutures. These sutures were first designed by Joel Alcamo in 1956. However, FDA approved it in 2002. Barbs serve as a grip to the suture tissue in a continuous manner. It retains tensile strength. It can either be unidirectional or bidirectional. Unidirectional barbed sutures is a single direction secured by a looped end to knot the suture finally. Whereas bidirectional barbs is both directions so that one end anchors the other and there's no securing knots. Main benefits of barbed sutures: eliminate surgical knots, knot-related complications, and increased efficiency of wound closure. It's used for cosmetic purposes and minimally invasive and laparoscopic procedures, especially in vesicourethral and GI anastomosis. A small note on novel sutures. They developed in the recent times with additional properties modified with antimicrobial and bioactive molecules such as drugs, proteins, growth factors, silvers, and antibacterial agents. They mainly developed off late to reduce the postoperative surgical site infections, which reduces by reducing the bacterial growth and adherence over the suture. And also it hastens healing. So what are the different types? Antimicrobial sutures, it can either be antibacterial agents or silver nanoparticles. Drug eluting sutures, which delivers drugs like antibiotics, local anesthetics, anti-inflammatory and analgesics. Stem cell seeded sutures, either by growth factors or stem cells. Smart sutures, where shape memory and elastic sutures or electronic sutures. Coming to suture needles.
Okay, Vanita, just hold on. There are some questions. Anybody wants to comment or anything?
Yeah, I just put up a question, Namita. Can you describe one single characteristic difference between hydrolytic and enzymatic absorption processes? One cardinal difference.
So there's lesser tissue reaction with enzymatic suture materials.
It's actually the other way around, isn't it? Hydrolysis is less reaction, actually.
Yeah.
When enzymes are involved, it's more reaction. But more importantly, enzymatic absorption is unpredictable.
Correct.
So the given time of absorption is never right in that class of sutures. Whereas hydrolytic absorption is always predictable, and the numbers quoted can be generally believed.
What are the knot related complications?
The slippage of knots.
Okay.
Behind the knot can cause persistent infection in some cases. Sinus formation.
Can be a nidus for infection. Right? Anything else?
Basically, slippage or securing, lesser security of knot.
Okay.
Yeah, that is, in fact, you put it in a different way. A knot is the weakest part of your suture.
Apparently, it reduces the tensile strength by 50% when we take a single knot.
Yeah.
So what are the precautions you take to prevent knot getting damaged while suturing?
So one is careful handling of the suture material.
Wow, how careful, what all care you take?
So So use of a needle holder at the, or an artery forceps at the end of the suture, at the tip of the suture material usually, and not, you know, in between the material.
Good, yeah. Don't hold anywhere in the suture. No, a lot of people, while pulling the suture, you see they put an artery forceps to the suture in the middle and pull it up. So that makes the suture material weak in that area. So that's why burst abdomen can occur or incisional hernias can occur. Never ever damage the suture with artery forceps. Hold only, as you said, at the end of the suture. Okay, anything else?
Leaving behind as minimal as suture material,
Yeah. What about locking?
The number of knots thrown.
Now, locking sutures, they are more, that becomes wherever you lock the sutures, no? See, earlier, lot of sutures used to be locked and then put. Nowadays, we don't do that.
Yes.
So those areas may hold better, but this can again become a weaker area to suture to cut through. Anything else?
Yeah, if I can add to that, that's a very valid point, Shivram.
Yeah.
When you lock it, people wrongly think that it is more secure. It is not. At the area where the locking occurs, in fact, the suture material can become a little weaker. And more importantly, you get segmental hypertension. If you have a continuous spiral suture, when the wound expands and the edema increases, which inevitably does over the next 3 days, then the strength is uniformly spread across the whole length of the suture. Whereas if you lock it, it will be less in one locked segment and it can be more in another locked segment. With this variable segmental hypertension or tension, you end up with the suture cutting through tissues. So a locked suture is in fact less secure than a continuous spiral unlocked suture.
True. I think it's not recommended nowadays. Nobody uses. Nishant is asking, he's suggesting that don't lock your artery or my mosquitoes forceps when using it as a step for knotting. You understood, no? Stepping. So never lock it. That's a very good point, that area becomes weak again if you are holding it for stepping and then locking it. We should not lock it.
Yeah.
How far from the knot should we cut the suture removal for the cut the suture? Skin suture we have put. So between the sutures, how much length you have to cut? That's what you're asking, Nishant.
Sorry, sir, there was a mistake. My question was, what is the length of the suture material which should be left above the knot where we cut the suture?
Yeah.
Above the knot, what is the length of the suture we are supposed to leave behind?
Generally, 3 to 4 millimeters, Nishant.
Okay.
And of course, if you are worried about security of the knot, you may have to leave it a little longer.
Yes, sir.
Go on.
I read somewhere that it should be as minimal as possible, accounting for the memory of the suture material.
Exactly. And that translates to 3 mm. It's more interesting in the skin suture because the length that you leave behind should be less than the distance between two adjacent sutures. So if you leave, even because you're taking it out, if you tend to leave a long length, then the next suture, when you put it in, this long length of suture will interfere with the knotting of the next suture. So the length should be less than the distance between two sutures in skin suturing. And one other site that PGs may find interesting, not a great learning point, but interesting. If you grab a suture with an artery or a needle holder to step it, then electron microscopic pictures have been beautifully shown. If you see the Ethicon manual, you will know it, that it actually fractures the suture in a most horrible manner. You will never see when you see it with the naked eye that a suture can be damaged so much. Electron microscopic pictures show you how damaging it is to the suture. And the tensile strength of the suture can be reduced as much as 60% with one application or one grab with an artery forceps or a needle holder. 60% reduction in the tensile strength.
Dr. Lakshman, what's the alternative to stepping? A good practice stepping.
Sorry, say that again, Shivram.
Any alternative to stepping?
Put a finger. In fact, Nishant was recommending don't grab it, just but keep it on the surface. Yes, that is acceptable. But I think a finger is equally good. I always, if I have to step, see, stepping itself is generally not recommended because it means the tissue is under tension. So you must find some way of releasing it and reduce the tension. But yes, there will be situations where a little bit of tension does occur, but keep a finger on the knot rather than put any instrument on it, and that will effectively step it.
Right. Yeah. Also, instead of artery forceps, sometimes you can use simple forceps.
Yeah, but then keep it on it, but don't grab it. That is the important thing.
Namita, why it's called catgut? Can't hear you. Namita, we can't hear you.
It's made from the intestines of cattle or sheep.
Pardon? Catgut is made from what?
Intestines of the submucous of the sheep.
Correct.
Serous of the cattle, cows, sir.
Yeah, so it's a misnomer, not cat.
Not cat.
Yeah.
No? You should not think it's made up of cat's intestine or so. Earlier it was called because of some material which you used to use, a string used for that pit or so. Okay, it became cat. It's not made up of cat's intestine.
Pavan has raised his hand and maybe you can mute it or you want to say something, Pavan?
Yeah. Pavan.
Yes, sir. Sir. Actually, what we tell is especially for the skin suture, if you apply a single knot, if it slips, then don't apply that knot because it will, the arthritic wound will break up.
Correct.
Okay. Sure. Good point. Which is the smallest size suture material available? Right. 11-0. Okay. Ophthalmologists sometimes use it.
We routinely use 11-0, sir.
Oh.
And if it is possible, there is one suture is available, 12-0.
I see.
But we are not getting routinely that. Up to 11-0 echelon, we are using routinely.
Okay. We didn't know this. Plastic
finger, retentation, we are using that.
Okay. Thank you, Pavan. Why it's called MRSILK?
So it's treated or mercenized, and the outer layer is coated.
You are guessing.
I read it, sir.
See, it is derived from the person's name, George Merson. Okay, he is the Scottish pharmacist who started doing this eyeless sutures needle. Where the words earlier they were all using the eye needles, and the suture used to be come out of that. So he's the one who started the eyeless needles, which was totally suture material. So he had a company which was bought over later by the Johnson & Johnson. So it is the George Merson, in memory of his name, it is continued as MRSILK, MRSILINE, all these things. Okay. Any other things? You can carry on, I think. Word of antibiotic coated suture, is it beneficial? Okay, it's not antibiotic coated suture, it is antimicrobial suture coated suture. It's called Niclosan. Now most of the sutures coming are all containing Niclosan coated sutures. Niclosan is used for a long time. It's used in lipstick, nail polish, so many of these toothpaste, everything. it is useful to prevent bacterial colonization of the suture materials. Okay. Okay, Namita, carry on.
Coming to the suture needles, the ideal characteristic of a suture needle has to have high quality stainless steel, because normally stainless steel has about 12% of chromium. So even in exposure to oxygen, it forms chromium oxide and protects the outer layer from corrosion. It has to be of smallest diameter, stable in grasp of a needle holder, capable of implanting a suture material, has to be sterile and corrosive resistant. So as Sir mentioned, previously we had something called the IDE needle, where we had to load the suture material. Now it's obviously suture with or the atraumatic needle. So in the past, needle had eyes and suture material had to be loaded to it, which was time consuming, and needle holes in the tissues were considerably large than the suture material. Currently, eyeless or atraumatic with suture material embedded within the shank. There are three parts of a needle. It is the shank, the body, and the point of a needle. So the shank, the body, and the point. A few definitions. The cord length, it's a linear distance from the point to the shank. Needle length is the distance along the needle from the point to the shank. The radius of the needle is the distance from the body of the needle to the center of the circle along with the needle curves. And diameter is the thickness of the needle wire. This is the radius to the center of the circle, and the diameter is the thickness. So the point and the body can be divided into types. Dividing point types, it's cutting, where the body is triangular and a sharpened cutting edge along the inside curve. Reverse cutting is a cutting edge on the outside of the curve. When the body, when we say a round body, it can either have a blunt point or a taper point. Blunt point is commonly used for sewing friable tissues or in pediatric age groups, and taper point is the body is round and taper and it ends in a small triangular point. This is normally used for gastrointestinal surgeries. We also have another type as a side cutting or spatula points. It's commonly used in ophthalmic procedures. The body types. So a needle is normally classified as a, depending on the circle. So half a circle, 3/8, 5/8 J-shaped needle compound curve, half curved is also commonly called the ski needle and a straight needle. So half a circle needle is commonly used for gastrointestinal surgeries where we, for anastomosis. The quarter circle needles are commonly used for ophthalmic procedures. J-shaped needle is used when the area of surgery is lesser and commonly used in vaginal surgeries. We commonly use it for closure of 10 mm port wounds. A compound curve needle is used in ophthalmic procedures. A straight needle used to be used for suturing of skin, no longer preferred because of needle prick injuries. So the take home message is, depending on the characteristic of a suture, all of us have to decide on which suture material to use, depending on the tissues and the region of suturing. Thank you.
So it's not that what your senior used to use, same thing you use?
Normally, all of us, what we do is follow whatever we either learned in training or medical colleges or our seniors have used. But with experience, I think all of us, I mean, it can be modified depending on the characteristic of the suture.
You have to change. Okay. Five eighth needle, where it is used commonly? Dr. Pawan is asking. Dr. Pawan, can you tell?
or it is just like a J needle which are routinely used in the pelvic surgeries and the vaginal surgeries.
Okay. So
I think if I may chip in, it is important for you to know the principle as to why there are different curvatures. Can you say a few things about it, Namita? Why do we really need different curvatures on the needle?
So depending on the area of surgery and the depth of the tissues, we select...
Depth, not the area. You're right. It is the depth where you're doing the suturing that is important. Why is it important?
Easier to manipulate.
Why is it easier to manipulate? How do you... That is right. And how do you actually manipulate the needle? Nishant, you want to come in and have a go at it? I think we have discussed it once or twice.
Because it's in the depth, the movement of majority has to be through the wrist joint. So the more the curvature of the needle, we'll have a better through and through without causing too much of a tissue trauma or pull in that particular region.
Correct. I mean, put it in a different way. Please note that the force that you exert when you drive the needle, when you put the needle through the tissue, must be along the long axis of the needle. All right. So when you're on a surface, when you have a shorter circle, it doesn't matter because you're on the surface. When you push it along the axis of the needle, you know, you should not push it straight. You should push it in a curved manner where in conformity with the curve of the needle. When you do that, the tip comes out of the other end. If it's on the surface, you can manage with a smaller circle, with a smaller diameter, you know. But when you're working at the depth, you need to have a bigger segment of the circle. So when you're working in a more deeper tissue, you need to have 5/8. Whereas if you're at a more superficial level, 4/8 will be enough. That is half circle. Okay, that is the principle. So when you drive a needle, it must be along the axis, long axis of the curvature. Beginners keep pushing it straight down or pushing it horizontally. The tip never moves, but the needle itself bends. If you see it, it loses its shape. It's not circular anymore. You know, it's become straighter. So you must remember to drive the needle, and the deeper that you're working, deep in the pelvis, up under the diaphragm or deep inside a cave-like area, even in an obese person, better to have a needle with a bigger curvature on it. Right? That is the principle.
Very good points. Anything else? Someone is asking where, how do you decide when to remove the sutures?
I thought I'll cover that for the technique.
Next time.
We'll do it. Yeah, that's a good idea.
Okay. Yeah. So, all right, sutures, we'll cover next time. Freedom of mark. Okay. Anything else?
So for the postgraduates, which one do we prefer, reverse cutting or cutting, and why?
Yeah, Namita.
Reverse cutting is preferred. Since the cutting is outside, through the tissues, it's better to go through the tissues.
The cut through is lesser.
Yeah. Why is it so? It's a very simple.
Because the sharp edge is inside the tissues, not outside it.
Correct. Cutting through occurs between the edge of the tissue that you are cutting. You know, you are putting, driving the needle through, and the inner curve of the needle. So when you are driving it in the same direction, the inner curve can cut through and cut across and disrupt the edge of the tissue also. All right. So that has a higher chance of cutting through. Whereas if the cutting, the triangle, the edge is on the outside, then if it cuts through, it'll be cutting away from the edge of the tissue. So the chances of cutting through will be less. That is why reverse cutting is preferred. When you have very tough tissue, which you know for sure will not cut through, then you can use the classical cutting needle.
Right. Thank you, sir. If no more questions, shall we call it a day?
Yes, sir.
Yes, thank you. Good job, Namita. Congratulations.
Yeah. Yeah. Everybody can rate Namita now. Nishant?
I am too young to rate anyone, sir. So
he is diplomatic. He is diplomatic. I know why he is not rating. He will have it if he rates now.
The slides were a little monotonous.
Yeah.
No? You can improve the background. Namita?
Yes. Thank you, Baran.
Right? Otherwise, I think she did a good presentation. So we look forward to your next presentation on the suturing techniques. This week, a lot of ASI programs are there, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. I think all of you should log in. They are very good. After that, we'll meet.
Yeah.
No, sir?
Yeah, that'll be fine. Yeah, sure.
I think this is a very good platform for faculty also to present and improve their presentation skills. Whoever is interested, please contact Dr. Lakshman or me. So whenever there is a slot, we'll definitely accommodate, and it will be a good learning process for all of us, not only for postgraduates.
Absolutely.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody.
All right. Good night. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.